Let's go, girls.
Welcome back to Feminist Cocktail Hour. I'm JC, and today we are continuing our theme week, focusing on fabulous femmes de France with the story of Joan d'Arc and a cocktail that I'm calling a flaming Pear-ee. To make this cocktail, you will not need your sword and shield, but you will need the following ingredients. You're going to need some cognac, some pear juice, some lemon juice, a hollowed out lemon rind, a sugar cube, some ice, and then some weird equipment, like a lighter. It's gonna get real, guys. Well, you go wrangle all of that up. I am going to start the story of Joan d'Arc, or Joan of Arc. The truth is, Joan's name is actually kind of a mystery. She was born Jeannette and went by Jean, or sometimes Jehan. She was not from a place called Arc. Dark or Tark was maybe her father's surname, but in her village, most people used their mother's surname. It didn't help that she was illiterate. In early papers, her name is listed as Jehan La Pucelle, which means Joan the Maid. But Joan of Arc has such a nice ring to it, right? Sounds like a war hero. So that's what we're going to use for today. Joan of Arc was born in 1412 in the middle of the Hundred Years' War. And by the middle, I mean like pretty deep in. The war had been going on for like 75 years by the time Joan was born. The reason the war started was basically an inheritance dispute between England and France about who should be the king of France, an English guy or a French guy. When Joan was born, Charles VI was in charge. He was also known as Charles the Mad because he suffered from varying kinds of psychosis, perhaps because of all of the inbreeding that was going on back then. Now, there was also a lot of infighting in France between these two major French factions, the Armagnac, who are the good guys in our version of this story, and the Burgundian forces, who are aligned with the English. Now, because King Charles wasn't all there, his queen had to step in and sort of run things, and she ended up signing a treaty that said when her husband, King Charles VI, dies, Henry V of England should become the king instead of the dauphin, aka the heir, her son, Charles VII, who at the time was basically just a kid. Now, Charles VI and Henry V kind of mess up the queen's plan because they end up both dying just a few weeks apart from one another, leaving the throne nominally to Henry VI of England, who was just an infant. Enter Joan of Arc. So at 13 years old, Joan of Arc starts having visions at her farm in Domremy. She sees and hears three saints, St. Margaret, St. Catherine, and St. Michael, telling her that her destiny is to go to Charles VII and help him run out the English so that he can be crowned the rightful king of France. These visions are so real to Joan, they would often bring her to tears because of their glory. She could literally, like, hear them and see them before her. Now, over the centuries, many scholars have tried to find an explanation as to what these visions could have been. They have ranged from possibly epilepsy affecting one part of her brain, or schizophrenia, or maybe bovine tuberculosis from drinking unpasteurized milk. Hot take? I think that the visions were real. I know that sounds crazy, but I think she just got too much right. Now, before you call me a historical heretic, let's get started with our cocktail. We're gonna start by filling our cocktail shaker with some ice, 4 or 5 cubes, nothing too crazy. And then we're gonna add 3/4 ounce of lemon juice. Just simple, just to get things started. Now, the visions were, of course, just the start of things for Joan of Arc. Joan was not the kind of lady to get, you know, a message from God and then just sit around at home. At the age of 16, Joan, directed by her visions, traveled to Vaucouleurs to ask the local commander to grant her an audience with Charles, the Dauphin. Obviously, this commander thought she was nuts and told her to go home. But Joan was not to be deterred. She returned a few months later with the prophecy that the commander was about to receive information that a battle at Orleans had just been lost. Sure enough, shortly thereafter, he received a missive that in fact the battle had been lost. So the commander started to think, I don't know, maybe there's something to these visions. He decided to send her with an escort off to see Charles. Joan, in preparation for this trip, cut off all of her hair. Interestingly, Joan of Arc was the inspiration for the hairstylist hundreds of years later who began the bob hairstyle. Trendsetter. Anyway, Joan lops off her hair and starts dressing like a man in order mainly to protect herself as she makes this journey through enemy territory to see Charles. Now, Charles, of course, has a lot of doubts about this girl. Remember, his father was Charles the Mad. He knows the signs of mental illness. So when she comes to see him, he decides he has to, you know, test her authenticity. Instead of just showing up and saying, I'm Charles, the rightful heir, he hides himself in plain clothes amongst the members of the court and puts someone else on the throne. Joan, however, sees through this immediately and walks right to Charles, knowing that he is the rightful heir. Charles is impressed, though not fully convinced, and has all of his most prominent theologians examine Joan, but all that they find is that she's pious and chaste and humble, which is exactly what you want in a military leader. So, in 1429, Charles sent Joan out to fight for the soul of France. We are going to add a little bit of the soul of France to our cocktail. We're going to start by adding 2 ounces of cognac. Now, any brandy will be fine. Cognac is to brandy what champagne is to sparkling wine. It's just about the region where it's produced. So we're going to put 2 ounces of that in. And then we are going to add 2 ounces of Anjou pear juice. 2.5 ounces, let's do. Now, we're going to shake and strain while we enter the battle sequence. So Joan leads the troops to battle in Orléans, a city under siege. Now, to be noted that Joan never actually fought. On the battlefield, she would strategize, carry a banner, even give orders, but she never killed a man and never wanted to. She was injured several times, though. She received an arrow to her shoulder and a crossbow to her leg. Now, in Orléans, Joan helped the French take control of the English fortifications, proving that they were not an invincible threat, and earning herself the moniker of the Maid of Orléans. Now, after the battle, Joan pressured Charles to take the advice of the voices in her head and go to Rennes to be crowned the rightful king. It took quite a lot of convincing. She was getting a message from God. What more did he need? But eventually, he agreed, he was crowned, and Joan was there at the ceremony, taking a place of honor by his side. Not long after that, Joan was on her way to another battle in Compiègne when she was thrown from her horse and captured by Burgundian forces. Remember, the Burgundians are French, but they're aligned with the English. So they start negotiating with the English to secure Joan's release, and they ultimately hand her over for like a few thousand francs. Joan, imprisoned now, does try to escape. She leaps from her 20-foot-high window, but to no avail. By the way, I want to say that I think we have way too much Saint Joan in, like, cultural depictions of Joan of Arc, and not enough of, like, the fierce, like, jumping the fuck out of windows Joan. You know, that's more of the Joan that I want to see. It is well documented, actually, that Joan had the temper of, like a teenage girl. She would yell at her men for, you know, swearing or failing to attend mass. She would drive away all of their, you know, tawdry mistresses and the prostitutes who would hang around the camp. She was shaming them in a way that one can only do when they have the purity of youth on their side. She made her men feel the way Greta Thunberg makes us feel all the time. We can do better, guys. Now, after her capture, Joan was put on trial with more than 70 charges raised against her. The most essential to remember are heresy and cross-dressing. Now, neither of these were at the time capital offenses if they were a first-time offense. Initially, Joan was tried in public, but after repeatedly bettering her accusers by dodging their trick questions and humbly maintaining her claim of innocence, they decided to move the trials to be private. Throughout all of this, King Charles did nothing to help Joan. In fact, he distanced himself from her and made no attempt to secure her release. Now, Joan's trial was not actually conducted by the English military. It was conducted by the church, but she was not imprisoned in an ecclesiastical prison with nuns as her guards, as would have been typical in that time. Rather, she was placed in a secular prison with male soldiers being her guards. This is important because Joan was constantly under threat of violence from her male guard. They were frequently threatening to rape her. So Joan decided to start wearing her men's clothing again in order to physically protect herself against these attacks. However, this decision made her a repeat offender, so she was sentenced to death. That's right, technically, she was not sent to death for witchcraft or heresy, but for cross-dressing. Joan of Arc was burned at the stake in May of 1431. Legend has it that her heart was so pure, it remained intact even amidst the ashes. In truth, after she was burned, her body was placed on display so that no one could believe that she escaped, and her ashes were dumped into the Seine so that there would be no relics. Now, as an homage to the much more romantic legend, we're going to do some cocktail theatrics. We're going to take our hollowed out lemon rind, and I put a small hole in the bottom of it so that it sinks when we put it into our drink. We're going to place a sugar cube. My sugar cube is actually homemade. It's in the shape of a heart, and it's vanilla flavored. We're gonna put it into our lemon rind, and then we are going to pour 3/4 of an ounce of grain alcohol over our sugar cube. It's gonna melt it a little, but hopefully not too much. We're gonna float our lemon rind in our glass while we light a flame. Now, it's probably best for this recipe to use a long flame, lighter, but I don't have one, so I'm having to light this steak, which also feels on brand. And then we light our heart. There it goes. I don't know how well you can see it. I have no regrets about this. It looks great. The sugar is all caramelizing and bubbling. It's kind of fantastic. There were, of course, immediately regrets after Joan of Arc was killed. An English soldier stepped forward almost instantly and said, "We have murdered a saint and we will all be damned." Joan of Arc is actually one of the greatest emerging figures from the Middle Ages, a time when we have so little written history. But her story was so captivating, a farm girl guided by God to save her nation, that there was a lot of contemporaneous writing about Joan, and writing that lasted beyond her into generations to come. Ultimately, these later generations, of course, revisited her story, declared that she was a martyr and a saint. She became the patron saint of France, the patron saint of martyrs, and the patron saint of people who are ridiculed for their piety. So you might just consider the idea that the visions were real. I'm just saying, just a thought. All right, my drink is still on fire. I'm going to blow it out. It's nice, it's good. You get the pear, you get the cognac, you get a little bit of that caramelized sugar and that vanilla, not too strong. You can taste a little bit of the burnt lemon rind, which feels both incredibly appropriate and incredibly inappropriate as we honor our beloved Saint Joan. I hope that you enjoyed this episode of Feminist Cocktail Hour. I'm going to be back on Thursday with a new lady, a new libation. Until then, cheers.
Let's go, girls.